Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for signing in for the webinar today. My name is Matt White, and I'm an attorney here with Baker Donelson. My practice focuses primarily on broker-dealer and investment advisor issues, and I will be covering the first part of our presentation today, which is the 2015 SEC targets. And then Whitney Harmon, who is another attorney here, is going to focus on the 2016 labor law challenges and, in particular, on several of the issues coming out of the Department of Labor. I've got a few administrative notes that I'll start with. First, there's in the speaker box, there is a link to both mine and Whitney's bios and a link to our emails. And if you have any questions that come up following the presentation, you can feel free to reach out to us at any time. We'll be happy to answer those. During the presentation, if you have any questions, there is a question box where you can type in any questions you have. And again, we'll do our best to answer those during the presentation. And then after the presentation is over, y'all will receive a copy of the PowerPoint presentation via email. And like I said, you're welcome to reach back out to us if you have any follow-up questions, and we'd be happy to talk to you about it. And with that, we will get started. As I said, the first part of this presentation is on 2015 SEC targets. And what we've done is gone back through many of the SEC's enforcement actions this year and tried to group them into several areas in which we saw either a lot of activity or fairly significant activity. And the list of topics we're going to talk is there on the slide now. As most of you probably know, both the SEC and FINRA have relatively recently issued their annual priority letters for 2016. And all of these areas are listed on both the SEC's annual priorities letter for 2016 and on FINRA's priorities letter. So while the actions we're going to talk about today are all investment advisor actions, FINRA has highlighted these issues or these areas as issues in 2016 as well. And that's true for all of these with the exception of the compliance officer liability, which is primarily focused on SEC actions. The first area we're going to talk about today is unauthorized or inadequately disclosed fees. Some of the largest settlements we saw in 2015 involved advisors who had received fees or expense reimbursements to which the commission concluded they were not entitled. The first of these is Investment Advisors Act Release Number 4219 in October of last year. In that case, the matter involved investment advisors to private equity funds, and after certain triggering events, the advisors would terminate portfolio company monitoring agreements and then would accelerate payment of future portfolio monitoring fees. And the SEC concluded that the advisors failed to adequately disclose their receipt of those accelerated monitoring fees. In making that conclusion, the SEC acknowledged that the investment advisors both disclosed the fact that they would receive portfolio monitoring fees from the portfolio companies, and after an acceleration event occurred, they disclosed the amount of fees that had been accelerated. But what the SEC took issue with was the fact that they didn't disclose prior to the fund's commitment of capital that they may accelerate future monitoring fees upon termination of the monitoring agreements. That matter settled for approximately $39 million. In a second action in September of last year, an investment advisor to CDO clients charged and retained certain exchange fees from the issuers of securities held by the CDOs when the advisor recommended exchange transactions for its CDO clients. The SEC reviewed the transaction documents and found that the documents allowed the advisor to take certain actions and to receive certain fees, but did not specifically allow the advisor to charge or retain exchange fees. And thus, the SEC concluded that those fees should have gone to the CDO clients rather than the advisors. In that case, matters actually got significantly worse for the advisor because the commission concluded that the advisor sought to conceal those fees in the disclosure documents by labeling them as third-party costs, and therefore it sanctioned both the managing director who drafted the language in the agreements characterizing those fees as third-party costs and the chief legal officer for the advisor who supervised and participated in exchange transactions. That case settled for $21 million. In announcing those settlements, the SEC stated that full transparency of fees and conflicts of interest is critical in the private equity industry, and they will continue taking action against advisors that do not adequately disclose their fees and expenses. I guess the takeaway in this area is that fees that are paid to advisors for their services need to be both consistent with the governing documents and need to be clearly disclosed to any investors. The next area that we're going to look at deals with the violation of duty of best execution relating to share classes. And there are several actions last year in this area. I just picked one as a representative example, and it was from June of last year. In this case, the SEC charged an investment advisor to a mutual fund, violated its duty of best execution by selecting a more expensive share class for his clients for the purpose of generating more fees for the advisor. In this case, the mutual fund at issue had two different share classes, an investor share class that charged higher fees and an institutional share class that charged lower fees. The difference in fees was 25 basis points, and in turn, all 25 of those basis points went to the advisor. The SEC concluded that most of the advisor's clients were eligible to participate in the institutional share class. One of the interesting things about that conclusion is that the investor share class, which was the one with higher fees, had a $2,500 minimum investment amount, whereas the institutional share class that had the lower fees had a $100,000 minimum investment amount, and the company attempted to defend their choice of share class on that basis. Having reviewed the governing documents, the SEC found that the advisor was permitted to aggregate all of the assets of its clients invested in the mutual fund to meet the $100,000 minimum amount, and therefore a substantial number of its clients would have been permitted to invest in the institutional share class. And again, so in that case and in many others as well, the SEC has stated that by failing to place clients in the lower cost share classes, an advisor may be failing to seek best execution for their clients on those transactions. The next area has to deal with valuations of illiquid assets. This continues to generate quite a few enforcement actions. Two that I thought were worth discussing here. The first was in July of last year. Here, the commission charged an advisory firm with inflating the valuations of certain unlisted, thinly traded residential mortgage-backed securities. In this case, the investment advisor disclosed to its investors, administrators, and disclosed to its auditors that the valuations of those investments were obtained by an independent, market-grounded price quotes for the securities from registered representatives at two reputable broker-dealers. The SEC concluded that, in fact, the valuations were not generated by those representatives. In fact, the advisor itself internally supplied valuations to the representatives for them to pass off as their own. Eventually, the auditors questioned the legitimacy of the valuations and sought to interview the registered representatives who purportedly were providing these valuations. And the SEC concluded that the advisor affirmatively acted to mislead the auditors by scripting the conversations for the representatives to have with their auditors to ensure that it was consistent with the statements they had made previously. That matter was settled for $5 million. In a second action that's probably a little bit less egregious of a case, it was from March of last year. Here, the SEC charged that an investment advisor to three collateral loan obligation funds who raise money and in turn invest that money in distressed companies directed that nearly all of the valuation of their assets would be reported as unchanged from the valuations at the time the assets were originated, even though over time many of the borrowers had made only partial or made no interest payments at all. The takeaway in this area from the SEC's announcements of these two settlements is that valuations needed to be accurate and reasonably based in fact, and the SEC has made clear that they will target cases where subjective discretion over valuation levels influences the valuations. The SEC has concluded that using subjective discretion over valuation levels can both violate an advisor's fiduciary duty to their clients and also creates conflict of interests that then in turn raise disclosure obligations. Several of the enforcement actions we've talked about already have had underlying themes of failing to disclose conflicts of interest, in addition to other violations that we've talked about. The disclosure of conflict of interest has been a particular focus of the SEC and of FINRA over the past several years. In fact, in remarks in 2012, the co-chief of the SEC's asset management unit has said that in nearly every ongoing matter for the asset management unit, they are examining, at least in part, whether the advisor in question has discharged its fiduciary obligation to its clients with respect to conflicts of interest and either eliminated them or, two, mitigated them and disclosed their existence to boards or investors. Over and over again, we see advisors failing to properly identify and then address their conflicts of interest. Two particularly significant, or one particularly significant enforcement action in this area was in December of last year. This was the largest investment advisor settlement of the year. And the investment advisor, the SEC concluded that the investment advisor failed to disclose that they preferred to invest client money in firm-managed mutual funds and hedge funds, and therefore clients were denied all of the facts to determine why investment decisions were being made by their investment advisors. In a second action, in August of last year, the SEC concluded that an advisor failed to disclose a conflict of interest related to a $50 million loan that a senior executive of the advisor had received from an advisory client. The SEC concluded that this created a potential conflict of interest whereby the advisor might place that client's interests over that of other clients. In announcing that settlement, the SEC stated that as fiduciaries, investment advisors must be vigilant about disclosing all material facts to their clients, including actual and potential conflicts of interest. There, the advisor unlawfully failed to disclose the conflict of interest created by the outside business activities of one of its senior executives. As I mentioned, there were numerous conflict of interest actions last year. One other area where there have been kind of repeated focus from the SEC relates to the bottom two actions listed on this slide. These are both currently being litigated, and both involve cases where an owner or affiliated individuals had a financial interest in investments recommended by their advisors. And the SEC has concluded that has stated that by failing to make disclosure of these conflicts of interest, the advisor deprived its clients of their right to exercise their independent judgment to determine whether the conflict of interest might impact portfolio management decisions. As I said, both of those cases are currently being litigated, but I think are examples of the focus the SEC has given to this area. The next area of focus for the SEC and for FINRA this year relates to misrepresentations and omissions. There are dozens of cases alleging misrepresentations and omissions each year. I tried to distill these down into a few different areas. The first one where we saw some activity relates to accurate disclosure about investment strategies and the investments themselves. The SEC has said that advisors must provide investors and fund boards with accurate information about a fund's investment strategy. In October of last year, the SEC announced a settlement in which an investment advisor to a continuously offered closed-end registered investment company made material misrepresentations and omissions concerning a material change in the fund's investment strategy. Here, for nearly a decade, the fund invested primarily in distressed debt, and then in 2008 reversed their strategy and started shorting credit primarily through credit default swaps. And the commission charged that the advisor misrepresented the fund's investment strategy in various communications to investors, prospective investors, and the board, and caused the fund to misrepresent its strategy in filings with the commission. This matter settled for $17.5 million, which included disgorgement, compensation to investors, and a $3 million penalty. In another area related to misrepresentations and omissions, the SEC has brought numerous cases alleging misrepresentations regarding fund performance, assets under management, or the background of their advisors. One case I thought was particularly interesting here was settled in November of last year, and here the SEC charged that an advisor made misstatements to certain of its mutual fund clients concerning the performance track record of its sub-advisor's algorithm-based rotation strategy. What's significant about this case is in making representations about the strategy, the advisor relied on representations it received from its sub-advisor, which of course was much more familiar with the strategy because it was their own. Essentially, the SEC's assignment of fault against the advisor here was that the advisor did not fact-check the statements it received from its sub-advisor with respect to the strategy. The next area I wanted to talk about here is probably of no surprise to anyone that it's been a focus of both the SEC and FINRA, and it relates to cybersecurity policies and procedures. Rule 30A of Reg SP essentially requires that both investment advisors and broker-dealers adopt written policies and procedures that are reasonably designed to keep customer personally identifiable information secure. In action in September of last year, the SEC concluded that for approximately 4 years, an advisor stored sensitive personally identifiable information of its clients and other persons on a third-party hosted web server without adopting written policies and procedures regarding the security, confidentiality, and protection against unauthorized access. In July of 2013, the firm's web server was attacked by an unauthorized person who gained access rights and copyrights to the data on the server. And as a result of that attack, the personally identifiable information of more than 100,000 individuals, including thousands of the advisor's clients, was rendered vulnerable to theft. Some of the interesting aspects of that case are, first, that there was no allegation that any of the personally identifiable information of the clients or of other individuals was actually stolen. The SEC acknowledged that it was simply at risk of being stolen or vulnerable to being taken. Further, the SEC conceded that after the breach, the advisor took appropriate action, including notifying the proper authorities, notifying customers, and providing credit monitoring where appropriate. Nevertheless, the SEC concluded that the firm failed to adopt written policies and procedures reasonably designed to protect customer records and information in violation of Reg SP. That matter was settled for a $75,000 civil penalty. In announcing the settlement, the enforcement staff gave some insight into their interest in this area by stating, "As we see an increased barrage of cybersecurity attacks on financial firms, it is important to enforce the safeguards rule even in cases like this where there is no apparent financial harm to clients. Firms must adopt reasonable policies and procedures to protect their clients' private information, and they need to anticipate potential cybersecurity events and have clear procedures in place rather than waiting to react once a breach occurs." This is one of the areas in particular that we expect to see quite a bit of activity going into 2016. The last area I wanted to talk about today relates to compliance officer liability. excuse me. As I mentioned before, this has been primarily a focus for the SEC, although it's probably not a surprise to anyone that FINRA often brings actions or allegations against compliance officers as well. As background, the Investment Advisors Act Rule 206.4.7 requires investment advisors to adopt and implement written policies and procedures that are reasonably designed to prevent violations of the Act and to appoint a chief compliance officer who is responsible for administrating those policies and procedures. The just leaves compliance officers vulnerable because they can be charged either with failing to adopt policies and procedures that would have prevented an underlying violation, or with failing to administer policies and procedures that would have prevented an underlying violation, or many instances charged with both. There appears to be a split within the SEC on the propriety of charging compliance officers in these actions. In 2015, then Commissioner Daniel Gallagher had issued a statement stating that the Commission's enforcement actions against compliance officers fly in the face of his admonition that the Commission should tread carefully when bringing enforcement actions against compliance personnel. In response to his statements, both Chair Mary Jo White and then Commissioner Luis Aguilar responded, stating that CCOs who do their jobs competently, diligently, and in good faith should not worry about being targeted in SEC enforcement actions. However, between 2010 and 2014, our research showed that the SEC brought enforcement actions against 72 chief compliance officers, and in 2013 alone, nearly one in every five actions against an investment advisor included charges against the advisor's chief compliance officer. In fact, in its list of SEC accomplishments for the period of April 2013 to August 2015, the Commission highlighted the fact that it brought a number of enforcement actions holding gatekeepers accountable for the important role they play in the securities industry. In making the announcement, the SEC singled out attorneys, accountants, and compliance professionals as the gatekeepers who were being held accountable. About 2 weeks ago, the SEC held their annual SEC Speaks conference, and several times during that conference, they again indicated that in the coming year, they would focus on what they called gatekeeper actions, which falls right in this area. It appears that the Commission statements and the large number of enforcement actions against chief compliance officers in the last few years suggest that the Commission and the enforcement staff may treat compliance officers no differently than they treat any other potential defendant in an enforcement action. I've highlighted two cases here that discuss or raise allegations and findings specifically against compliance officers. The first was in April of last year. It's actually included in the materials above under a different point. But here, an investment advisor failed to disclose the outside business activities of one of its portfolio managers, and the SEC charged that the advisor that charged the compliance officer with causing certain violations, including failure to report the advisor's outside business activity and the resulting conflict of interest to the fund's board. The SEC concluded that the compliance officer was responsible for the fund's failure to have adequate written policies and procedures governing outside business activities, including how they should be assessed and monitored for conflict of interest purposes, and when an employee's outside business activity should be disclosed to the board of directors. This is the only case to date that we found that, among other violations, charged a violation of Rule 38A1, which requires annual reports to the board of each material compliance matter since the last report to the board. In announcing this settlement, the SEC stated that the advisor should have disclosed to the fund's board of directors and its advisory clients that the fund invested in a public company that had a joint venture with a private company in which the fund's portfolio manager had an interest. In a second action that included liability against the chief compliance officer, in June of last year, a former vice president of an investment advisor was found to have misappropriated at least $670,000 in assets from three clients. The SEC concluded that the advisor itself failed to adopt policies and procedures reasonably designed to prevent the misappropriation of client assets, failed to implement the policies it did have, and violated the custody rule, and included false statements in its form ADV. In addition to charging the firm, the SEC charged the advisor's chief compliance officer herself with failing to effectively implement a compliance policy requiring the review of cash flows in clients' accounts. The SEC also charged the compliance officer with failing to conduct an annual review, and ultimately charged the compliance officer with the responsibility for the material misstatements in the form, the advisor's form ADV. The CCO itself in that case was fined $25,000. And the firm was fined $17.5 million. I think both of these cases are representative of the SEC in particular's focus on compliance officers and their what appears to be a pattern of charging both firms and their compliance officers with liability for underlying violations. As I mentioned before, if anyone has any questions on any of these issues or any other broker-dealer investment advisor-related issues, you can feel free to let me know. My contact information is included at the end of this presentation and, again, on the speaker link. I don't see any questions right now, so with that, I will turn it over to Whitney.
Thanks so much, Matt, and thanks for letting me be part of this afternoon. Just wanted to say good afternoon to everybody again and talk about a couple of things in the federal employment law space. As most of you know, there's a lot going on in this space right now, and so we wanted to provide you with an update on a couple of things this afternoon, the two focuses being classification of independent contractors and also the Department of Labor's proposed overtime regulations that should be coming out any day now. We wanted to give you an update on both of these things and just talk through a little bit what they mean. So with that, let's go on and get started. We're going to talk first about the independent contractor classification and why there is a refocus on this issue. And we'll get through this and probably try to spend a little more time on the upcoming DOL regulations because I know that's an issue that everybody has some questions about. So in terms of the independent contractor question, this misclassification of independent contractors has been an initiative of the Department of Labor since about 2010. In 2010, the Department of Labor said that they were taking on this misclassification initiative because misclassification of employees as independent contractors presents a serious problem for the affected employees, employers, and to the entire economy. They went on to say that the misclassified employees that are often denied access to critical benefits and protections such as family and medical leave, overtime, minimum wage, and unemployment insurance to which those workers are actually entitled. And finally, they said employee misclassification also generates substantial losses to the Treasury and to Social Security and Medicare funds, as well as to state unemployment insurance and workers' compensation funds. So back in 2010, when the economy was trying to recover from the recession, that was the focus of the Department of Labor. They came out strong and said, we're putting a lot of effort and resources and funds behind this initiative to weed out these misclassifications and make sure people are classified correctly as employees and not as independent contractors. So for the past several years, that's been an ongoing initiative. They have not really back down, but over the past year or so, it's kind of taken a back seat and everyone started to pay more attention to the proposed regulations that are going to impact some exemptions. That was until about July or so of last year when the U.S. Department of Labor Administrator's interpretation came out where the administrator was saying, okay, what are we looking at when we're looking at independent contractors? So again, he takes up this issue of independent contractor misclassification and what the Department of Labor considers an employee versus an independent contractor. So he doubles down on this on the ongoing efforts to combat this independent contractor misclassification and provides what we call as additional guidance. It's called an administrator's interpretation. It's about 15 pages of guidance as to what the Department of Labor looks at when it's making a decision of whether or not a worker has been misclassified. In that interpretation, the administrator looks at the longstanding six-part economic realities test and defines the ultimate goal of determining whether the worker is economically dependent on the employer and therefore an employee, or is that worker really in business for him or herself and therefore an independent contractor. And there's a link on this slide to a copy of that interpretation if you'd like to go read that. So the question is, what's changed? Is there anything different from what we used to do when we were doing our analysis as to whether or not a worker was an employee or an independent contractor? In the administrator's opinion, the DOL's new guidance doesn't change the legal landscape, so it's not new law, which we agree with. It's just another installment of this ongoing DOL initiative. And we agree that this has been an initiative since 2010, that they're going to target this problem. They're focusing a lot of attention and effort on this. In fact, in around September of 2011, the Department of Labor and the IRS entered a memorandum of understanding to coordinate their efforts to combat this misclassification. They agreed to share information in that regard. The Department of Labor also entered into memorandums of understanding with 25 states to do the same thing, to share that information. And so we continue to ask the question, what's different? What does this new administrator's interpretation tell us that's different than what we've heard before? And kind of where is this focus coming from? Well, a lot of you have probably heard about the Uber case or even the Lyft case that is currently working its way through some settlement processes, but there is a lot of high-profile litigation going on right now in the context of independent contractors and misclassification of those contractors. For those of you who don't know, the Uber case is a case out of California, and the issue there is whether or not a class of Uber drivers have been misclassified as independent contractors and should have been classified as employees. Under California labor law, if they were employees, they would be entitled to reimbursement for expenses in the use of their automobiles. As most everyone knows, the Uber business model is very much a business model focused around independent contractors. Those workers choose when they're going to work. They drive their own cars. They pay for their own gas. They can turn their apps on and off whenever they want. They don't have to work any specific amount of time. And so that is a growing business model for lots of companies, Lyft, Uber, Airbnb, lots of other businesses in that space. And so these cases are getting a lot of attention. One of the Lyft cases, like I said, is going through the settlement process right now. But the Uber case has been really picking up steam. The class was conditionally certified. Uber lost their summary judgment motion. An issue has been appealed about some arbitration clauses. But that case is still ongoing and getting a lot of attention. And so with those cases out there and with the administrator's recent interpretation, we're now looking at what the new test is or what the different test is for our analysis of whether a worker is an independent contractor or an employee. If you talk to most employment lawyers, they would say that things have probably changed. Contrary to what the administrator says, the DOL's new emphasis on this economic dependence and the bold statements included in that guidance from the Department of Labor really emboldened the Department of Labor to aggressively combat this independent contractor misclassification and kind of change the game in that regard. It remains to be seen what courts will do with this, whether or not they are going to stick with the tests and the analysis that we've used in the past, or whether or not they're going to take up the language from the administrator's guidance and start relying on that. But that's one of those things that we have to continue to watch. So this new economic dependence analysis has to be considered as an overarching consideration when we are looking at these classifications and whether or not a worker falls properly into an independent contractor classification. While it's always been part of this economic realities test, as most of you know, in the past when we've looked at independent contractors, people have focused more heavily possibly on the control factors. And based on the administrator's guidance, that's no longer the appropriate focus. It's now this economic dependence analysis. So is the employee economically dependent, or excuse me, is the worker economically dependent on the company, on the employer, or is that person truly in business for him or herself and therefore more properly an independent contractor? So, there's six parts to this economic realities test, and the administrator says that none of these factors are determinative, that employers must look at all the factors, must weigh all the factors, and determine on an individual basis whether or not the proper classification has been met. So the first part, the first test, is the work that the worker is doing an integral part of the employer's business. This is the one that kind of makes me scratch my head, because when I think back to the Uber litigation, clearly the work of those workers driving people around is integral to the part of an employer's business. But I would argue that those Uber drivers are independent contractors. So we're going to get into a little bit more about that in just a minute. So you see here, the thought here is that the workers are more likely to be employees of a company if they are performing the company's primary work. Now, again, the administrator says nothing here is determinative. You have to look at all of these and do this analysis. So just because even in the Uber context, the work that they're performing is an integral part of that employer's business doesn't automatically take them out of the rest of the analysis. One thing that I think was helpful from the administrator's interpretation was some of the examples given throughout those 15 pages. For example, here, the administrator says if you take a construction company, framers are most likely employees because they're doing the integral work of the employer's business, but a software developer who might develop software or design software to track bids or some other part of the project may be classified as an independent contractor because that's more of an ancillary function. So that's the first factor. The second is, does the worker's managerial skill affect the worker's opportunity for profit or loss? Now, again, this goes back to that economic dependence. And with an independent contractor who is in business for him or herself, those people can make management decisions, such as deciding to hire an assistant, hire additional people to help get the job done, purchasing additional materials, advertising, PR, things like that. And those decisions can directly affect the opportunity for profit or loss for that worker. Employees, by contrast, don't have the ability to spend money specifically on things like that. Okay, so when we're looking at factor three, how does the worker's relative investment compare to the employer's investment? Even when we were focusing on control, we would talk about the worker's investment. So is the worker providing his or her own tools? In the Uber situation, they're driving their own car. The administrator takes us a step further and talks about the relative investment compared to the employers. So instead of talking about basic tools and things like that, the administrator is saying that the independent contractors really need to be making significant capital investments. So those capital investments need to be more significant than things like tools or supplies. They're capital investment to such a degree that they can operate as an independent business. So if they decide to, they can leave working with that company, go somewhere else, take the tools, the equipment, whatever it is that they've purchased, and do similar work for a different group. So this investment or the use of tools and equipment and things like that, it's more of a significant capital investment on the independent contractor side. The fourth factor is, does the work performed require special skill and initiative? This has always been part of the test, of course, and it's always been a little bit confusing because there are arguments that can be made probably around any position that the position requires special skill and initiative. According to the Department of Labor and to even some courts, special skill doesn't mean technical skills required to perform that particular job, since many employees are skilled laborers. The DOL interprets this factor to require a special skill and initiative that permits that independent contractor to operate as an economically independent business. So again, every factor now is focused on this economic dependence and whether or not that worker is independent of the company or is reliant on the company, and that's really the tipping point. Factor five is the relationship between the worker and the employer permanent or indefinite? Always, of course, has been a factor as well. The concept here is that true independent contractors generally don't work for one company for an extended period of time. It's helpful that none of these are determinative because in certain industries, I just don't think this fits. Certain industries have independent contractors who may work with a company for years, but they may be working with other companies as well. So again, you have to do this independent analysis for each group to make sure that they fit within the proper test. And then number six, this is where we finally get back to control. So the factor that maybe everyone relied on most heavily before is now number six on the list. What is the nature and degree of the employer's control? Courts have been on board with considering this kind of the most important of the six factors in the past years. The DOL is disagreeing. And that's really the purpose of this interpretation that we're getting from the administrator. The DOL here places a lot of emphasis on this economic dependence, and they say that the worker has to have meaningful control over meaningful aspects of his or her work. And his or her control has to be more than theoretical. They have to actually exercise it. Importantly here, especially in several industries that are heavily regulated, the administrator comes out directly in the interpretation and says, control is control is control. We at the Department of Labor do not care if the control that's exercised over a worker is because of some federal regulation or requirement, that's still exercising control over that employee. And so, or over that worker, and so that would lean more towards an employee relationship rather than an independent contractor relationship. So again, the administrator saying things didn't change. Lots of other people are saying the test is a little different now. We're certainly focused on different pieces at this point, but the key words to remember here are economic dependence, and that's really what the Department of Labor is focusing on. Now, I will say this. In the Uber litigation, one of the interesting pieces, early on in that case, when the proposed class was going through the certification process, the court did exclude any workers who had signed up to work with Uber through their own entity, so through an LLC or some other legal entity, rather than as individuals. So the court was comfortable saying, okay, these separate legal entities can be independent contractors, but we're not sure about the individuals. So I do think that that's an interesting point when you're thinking about your independent contractor relationships and your independent contractor agreements. Are those agreements with individuals, or are they with companies that the individual has set up themselves? So that's an interesting piece that we'll continue to watch and see if that is something that kind of picks up traction. So other red flags when we're talking about independent contractors, first, do you have employees performing essentially the same duties as independent contractors? If so, those positions probably need a closer look. We want to make sure that people, that either group is classified correctly. And so if you have people who are performing essentially the same duties and they're classified differently, there's a good chance that one group needs to be reclassified. Second, have you classified the independent contractor as an employee in the past while that person was performing essentially the same task? So has someone's classification changed from an employee to an independent contractor? Then the question would be why. If they're doing the same thing, why has that classification changed? You'll need to be able to answer those questions. So that's a good place to start when you're taking a look at your independent contractors. Do either of those red flags come up, and if so, why? I'll throw out a couple of just important points to note here before we move on to the Department of Labor regulations. One, with independent contractors, it does not matter what the worker wants to be, how the worker wants to be classified. So even if a worker comes to you and says, I want to be classified as an independent contractor, if they don't fit into this test, so if their economic dependence leans more towards an employee relationship, then their desire doesn't really make a difference. It also doesn't matter what they agree to sign if they're not truly fitting in that test. So we see a lot of times where workers will come and say, I want to be an independent contractor for one reason or another, and I'll sign whatever you want me to, or here, I've even drafted this and I'll sign this. And if they don't fit in that test, those requests really don't matter. So a couple things to keep in mind. You as the employer or the company, you have the burden to prove the classification is correct. If it's a close question, it's always better to classify the worker as an employee because that guarantees them those benefits and things that they may not receive as an independent contractor. So that's the fail-safe, is to classify that person as an employee. When we talk about why this is such a big deal, not only are we talking about benefits, potential back pay if someone's owed overtime and things like that, but the IRS also has a stake in this to make sure that all the taxes are paid. The National Labor Relations Board has gotten on board with this because it has an interest in having more people available for bargaining units, and independent contractors are not available for bargaining units. So other agencies are taking a hard look at this too, and as all this scrutiny continues, just the spotlight in this area really isn't going away. So when we're talking about classification, it's always good to make sure you're comfortable with your independent contractor classifications and that you don't have concern in this area. Okay, so while we're on the topic of classifications, let's talk about the information that's going around and probably what a lot of you have been talking about in your own workplaces, and that is the Department of Labor's proposed regulations as they relate to current exemptions. In March, this kind of all started back in March of 2014, when President Obama sent a memorandum to the Secretary of Labor. The memorandum was about the white-collar exemptions, saying they were outdated, that millions of Americans should be paid overtime, and they're not because the regs are outdated and they need to be updated. The quote on the slide kind of sums it all up. I mean, his message was clear. Therefore, I hereby direct you to propose revisions to modernize and streamline the existing overtime regulations and simplify the regulations to make them easier for both workers and businesses to understand and apply. So with those marching orders, the Department of Labor got to work, and about 15 months later, they introduced their proposed changes to the Fair Labor Standards Act regulations on the white-collar exemptions. That was a 295-page document that you can look at regulations.gov if you'd like to, but I'm going to summarize it for you. For those of you who may not have been keeping up with this from the beginning, that proposed rule sent shockwaves through the business community. The rule took the white-collar exemptions, so the executive, the administrative, the professional, those white-collar exemptions, and completely shook them up. Remember, when we're talking about exemptions, so when we're talking about an exempt employee, the exemption depends on three things. First, how the employees are paid, the salary basis test, as we've called it in the past. An employee must be paid a predetermined and fixed salary that is not subject to reduction because of variations in the quality or quantity of work performed. That includes no partial pay deductions and other things. So that salary basis is kind of a threshold test. If you can get past the salary basis, then you go into the rest of the test. So how much is the salary? What is the salary level? Currently, that number is $455 per week, or $23,660 per year. So that's the number that we have been focused on for years now. And that is where President Obama is saying, this needs to be updated. This is not current. It's outdated. It needs to be updated. It's too easy to put people into those exemptions. So currently, if you're making more than $455 per week, you're meeting that threshold salary, then you go next to the job duties test. So what kind of work is this employee or this group of employees, what are they doing? Each category of exemptions, they have their specific requirements for job duties, and those are set out in the regulations. Right now, in the proposed rule, those did not change, but we're going to talk about the caveat that I have about that in just a minute. So salary basis test, are they paid on a salary basis? What's the salary level, and then what are the job duties? That's how we fit people into these exemptions. So what changes did the DOL propose? When they came out with that proposed rule, what did they say? What they said is, we're going to take that salary level, that $455 per week, and we're going to more than double it. So the new proposed salary threshold for an exemption, for one of these white-collar exemptions, is $970 per week. So that's more than $50,000 a year. Now, when I say this sent shockwaves through the business community, we all expected an increase in the salary level. I think everybody could agree that that might have been a little outdated, and we expected some type of salary increase. I think the idea of doubling it just floored pretty much everybody. It certainly did us. And so that was a huge, huge pill to swallow, and that's what everyone's been trying to do since this proposed regulation came out. How are we going to adapt to this new requirement? What are some other changes? Another change was when we're talking about these white-collar exemptions, there's also the highly compensated employee exemption. That salary level is currently $100,000 annually. So if you had an employee who didn't quite fit into one of those other exemptions that I mentioned, but they were getting paid over $100,000 a year, there was an exemption for them, the highly compensated salary employee exemption. That exemption has also gone up, the salary level for that. And the new proposed salary threshold is $122,148. This should be the 90th percentile of earning for full-time salaried workers. That was an additional change that's been proposed. So the question becomes, what can we include in that salary level to get our employees to that 50,000-plus number? The proposed rule gave some guidance on that, but it was not totally clear. First, the question about bonus or incentive pay, probably, but it's going to be limited. So probably not if we're talking about catch-up payments. So they're not at that 50,000 by the end of the year, and we want to catch them up to that number. The Department of Labor is probably not going to allow those catch-up payments to be included. Non-discretionary bonuses, so the employee knows what he or she has to do to get those bonuses, possibly. So bonuses that are tied to productivity, profitability, specified performance metrics, those type of things. Bonuses that are paid frequently, employees have to receive the bonus payments frequently. So we're still waiting on some really clear guidance from the Department of Labor here in this space about what can we include. Commissions, this is an interesting one. Originally, the Department of Labor is saying probably not including commissions in that over $50,000 number. The interesting thing here, obviously, is they sought comments on this. They received over 250,000 comments on this proposed rule, and my guess is there was a significant amount of comments on this commission's piece and getting clarity really on what employers can include to get to that 50,000 number. Other paid benefits, they were pretty clear, likely no. We're not going to include the value of other paid benefits to help the employers get to that $50,000 number. So that 50,000 plus number really is a salary, a base salary, and everything else is on top of that. Again, I said they received over 250,000 comments on this, so that's what they've been working on in the preceding months, and so we're hoping to get some more clarity when we see a final rule, and we're going to talk about that in just a minute. So a summary of these proposed changes again, increase of that salary level test, now you're hitting that 50,000 plus number, increase in the total compensation required for highly compensated employees, and number three is one of the ones that I think is probably, I know the doubling of that weekly pay is a hard pill to swallow, but I think this one's really also very painful. Establishing a mechanism for automatically updating the salary and compensation levels annually. Now, when President Obama said this was outdated, we haven't increased that salary basis for quite some time, and a lot of federal statutes like this will have these automatic provisions where these amounts will escalate. The Fair Labor Standards Act didn't have that, so arguably, yes, that was an outdated provision, and it possibly should have been going up. Having it go up annually and that percentage being tied or either based on a percentage or possibly tied to the consumer pricing index is a piece that really, especially as we're looking at how to get prepared for this, I think is a big deal. Because when we talk to employers about how do we prepare for this, the first thing we talk about is start auditing your workforce now. Look at the groups who are going to be impacted by this. And so those would be the groups who are currently exempt, but they're not near that $50,000 number. So when this final rule comes out, and that number likely lands either at $50,440 or close to that, those employees are automatically going to be non-exempt. Now, if you have some workers who are already over that $50,000 or are close to being over the $50,000 and you make the determination that it makes sense to raise them up to the $50,000 plus number, so that they can keep the exemption, it's important to know that number is not going to stay at $50,440. It is going to increase, possibly annually. Again, I'm sure there were several comments about that, about whether or not it should be annually or every couple of years, or how that annual increase is going to work, and we just don't have those answers yet. But it's important to know that for that salary level and even the highly compensated employee salary, those numbers are going to increase. Those escalator provisions are going to be included in the final rule. Okay, so again, when we talk about all of this, we get questions, especially now that we've been getting some comments and some articles and things like that coming out about when all this is going to take effect. For a long time, we didn't have much answer for that. But in the past few weeks, we've gotten a little more activity, and so we have a little more guidance in terms of when these when this final rule might be coming out and when employers might be required to be compliant with it. March 14th, the Department of Labor sent the Office of Management and Budget its final changes for determining which workers are eligible for overtime pay, so its final rule. Now, at this point, Office of Management and Budget has to approve that rule. That could take as long as several months or as short as a few weeks. There's a lot of commentary about the fact that this has gained a lot of speed, and we don't see that slowing down anytime soon. So the thought that this will get pushed through pretty quickly is probably the majority view at this point. Most people are saying that we think that it's going to work its way through OMB pretty quickly and be published by sometime this summer. And then after the publishing, that the rule will take effect maybe 60 days later. So that gives employers a very short time frame to get prepared for this change. So when we talk about getting prepared, we talk about things like performing those audits, looking at your classifications, looking at the compensation levels, so you know who might be on the bubble for losing an exemption. Do we have workers in the same class, in the same job, who are all currently classified as exempt, and some of them are now going to be under the salary level for the classification, and some are going to stay above that classification or that salary level. If so, how do we treat those? So doing, performing those audits and having people assist with those audits is very important, so you have a good idea of how this is going to impact you. When we talk about the audits, we look at the people who are on the bubble. We talk about, does it make sense to increase the salary so that they keep the exemption? And how do we know? Okay, well, we have to look at the, somewhat of a time study. How much are these people working? What is the overtime going to cost us if they now become non-exempt workers and they are punching that clock, they are tracking their time, and we are having to compensate them for overtime? And then, of course, on the back end is, what is the communication to our employees? How do we communicate this change? And so all of those are things that you should be thinking about now, since we seem to be on the speeding train towards this final rule that's going to impact everybody. I will say there has been a bill that has been introduced by some Republicans in Congress. It was introduced actually on March 17th, and it's legislation that calls for stopping this final rule in its tracks. The bill proposes that not only that the rule be nullified, but that the DOL be required to go back and conduct a comprehensive economic analysis on the impact of this mandatory overtime expansion to non-business, not or to small business, nonprofit, and public employers, those groups who many people think are going to be the most impacted by this. It also asks to prohibit these automatic increases in the salary threshold, so this annual increase that's being proposed, it asks for that to be prohibited, and it asks that any future changes to the duty test must be subject to notice and comment. So I mentioned earlier that I've come back to this point. In the proposed rule, there were no changes to the duties test, which is where everyone thought the changes would actually fall. Those did not happen. However, there was language in the proposed rule that asked for comments about whether or not the duties test should be changed. So there's a lot of commentary and concern that that opened the door for the Department of Labor in its final rule to actually change the duties test without giving everyone the time to comment on those proposed changes. So there is a strong concern that when this final rule comes out, there will be changes to the duties test that we've never seen before. And so that's another concern that this legislation is trying to stop. So again, we know this final rule is coming. It's coming sometime soon, and we're hoping that all of you are making efforts to be prepared. I see that we're running out of time, so I don't want to keep you any longer than we already have. I want to thank you all again. We appreciate you being with us this afternoon. As Matt said, feel free to reach out to us if you have any additional questions. Otherwise, have a great afternoon. Thank you so much.